The convection heat transfer coefficient is not always easy to calculate with a simple formula in many cases. That's where CFD comes in as an effective tool to estimate it. Hello, this is Armin. Before we jump into the simulation, let me briefly explain what this coefficient means. Convection heat transfer is the process of heat transfer between a solid surface and a moving fluid, either a liquid or a gas that's in contact with it. There are two main types of convection, forced and natural. Forced convection happens when an external source, like a fan or a pump, drives the fluid motion. In contrast, natural or free convection, which is the focus of this video, occurs due to buoyancy forces caused by temperature-induced density differences in the fluid. In simple cases, we can estimate the convection heat transfer coefficient using analytical formulas. However, many real-world scenarios are too complex for these methods. That's where CFD comes in. It's a widely used and reliable approach to calculate the convection coefficient. This tutorial will use ANSYS Fluent to simulate natural convection over a vertical plate. The model is two-dimensional, with ambient air at 20 Celsius and a 20 centimeters high plate maintained at a constant 70 Celsius. ANSYS Fluent gives an H value of 5.39 watts per square meter per Kelvin, which is very close to the analytical result of 5.2, a good validation of the simulation accuracy. Now, let's get started modeling. I'm going to start by adding fluid flow fluent. Since we're performing a 2D simulation, we cannot select fluent meshing. Next, I'll right-click on the geometry cell and choose SpaceClaim. Once it opens, let's begin by creating a rectangle. I'll select the rectangle tool and click on the origin of the coordinate system. We want the dimensions to be 1,000 millimeters by 500 millimeters. Pay attention to the direction of the coordinates. Now, I want to add another rectangle in a specific area. I'll hover the cursor over the edge coordinate, press Shift, and you'll see the dimensions being added. Let's input 100 millimeters and press Enter. The height of the wall will be 200 millimeters. The length of the edge isn't important, so I'll set it to 100 millimeters as well. Once done, click in Sketch Editing. We don't need this extra geometry section because I only want to apply temperature to the surface wall, so I'll select it and delete it. This entire geometry represents the fluid domain, and this particular surface is the wall where I want to calculate the convective heat transfer coefficient. Let's name each part to keep things organized. I'll go to Groups and click Create Name Selection. Select the wall surface and name it wall surface. The surrounding boundary lines represent the environment, so I'll name them outlet. The sidewalls will also be named wall, but note, I don't want to calculate the heat transfer coefficient for these walls, only for the main wall surface. Everything looks good. Now I'll close SpaceClaim. Now it's time to create the mesh, so I'll navigate to the mesh cell and double-click on it. Let's wait for it to open. In the Mesh Details panel, we can see the global element size, which is currently around 56 millimeters. For our simulation, I think 10 millimeters will be more appropriate. Let's go ahead and generate the mesh. The mesh has been generated successfully. To improve the accuracy, it's better to add a boundary layer mesh on the walls. I'll right-click on Mesh, go to the Insert menu, and select Inflation. In the Geometry scope, select the entire domain and click Apply. In the Boundary scope, select the walls and click Apply. Now, let's update the mesh. As you can see, two inflation layers have been created by default. We can improve the resolution further by increasing the number of layers to 5, then updating the mesh again. This will provide better accuracy for our simulation. Everything looks good. Under name selection, we can still see the section names we defined earlier in SpaceClaim. We can also create additional name selections here if needed. Now, I'll close the meshing window and move on to the setup step, where we'll prepare the model. I'll start by checking the double precision option and setting the number of CPUs to 8, then click Start to begin the setup. First, we need to enable gravity so that natural convection can occur. Set the gravitational acceleration to -9.81 in the appropriate direction. Next, we need to enable the energy equation to include temperature effects in the simulation. You can find the energy option in the model section. Since we're dealing with a temperature gradient, this step is necessary. I'll keep the default fluid model as it is. Now we need to define how the density of air changes with temperature. To do that, I'll go to the materials section and, under fluids, double-click on air. There are a few options for defining density, such as ideal gas, incompressible ideal gas, Boussinesq. Since the temperature difference is small, the Boussinesq approximation is a good choice. We need to specify the reference density as 1.225 and set the thermal expansion coefficient to 0.0034. You can easily find the value of air's thermal expansion coefficient online. Once that's done, click Change and Display, and close the window. The material is now set up correctly. Now, let's define the boundary conditions. I'll go to the Boundary Conditions section and expand it. Under Outlet, I'll select the boundary we named Outlet. Here, we need to specify the ambient temperature. Since this is a steady-state simulation, the outlet temperature will define the environment's temperature. I'll go to the Thermal tab and enter 20 Celsius. But the default unit is Kelvin, so we need to change that. To do this, I'll navigate to the Domain tab, click on Units, locate temperature, and switch the unit from Kelvin to Celsius. Now, simply need to close the window. Now we can input the temperature directly in Celsius. I'll enter 20 and click Apply. Now the fluid temperature is set to 20 Celsius. I'll go to the wall section, expand it, and select the wall surface. Then I'll open the Thermal tab and check the temperature option. Here, we need to specify the wall temperature, which in this example is 70 Celsius. I'll enter the value and click Apply. The material name doesn't matter here because we're applying the temperature directly to the wall, not to the domain. Everything is now set up correctly. Let's move on to the initialization step. I'll keep the default settings and click Initialize. Next, I'll go to Run Calculation, set the number of iterations to 500, and click Calculate. Now we wait for the solution to be completed. The solution is complete. I'll click OK, and let's check the scaled residuals. Natural convection is usually an unstable solution, so it may not fully converge in steady-state simulations. However, the residuals are acceptable in this case, and we can trust the results. Now, I'll go to the Results tab and hit Surface Integrals. Under Surface Integrals, I'll change the report type to Facet Average and select the wall surface. In the Field Variable section, I'll change the variable from pressure to wall fluxes. Then, from the drop-down menu, I'll select Surface Heat Transfer Coefficient. Now we just need to click Compute to see the result. The convection heat transfer coefficient is now displayed in the console window. As you can see, the heat transfer coefficient for convection in our simulation is approximately 5.39 watts per square meter Kelvin. In order to corroborate the findings, I operated the same case within quick field with the same material properties. The simulation produced a result of approximately 5.2, very similar to the result we obtained in Fluent. This slight discrepancy makes us confident that our results are correct. Let us now have a look at the velocity and temperature contours to see the flow better. I will proceed to the graphics section, enlarge it, right-click contour, and make a new plot. Under settings, I will choose temperature and save and display. You can easily observe the temperature gradient that exists around the vertical surface, exactly as predicted. Next, let's check the velocity contour by changing the current temperature contour to velocity. As expected, the velocity is very low, which is typical for natural convection cases. As I mentioned earlier, the residuals didn't fully converge in the steady-state simulation. One way to improve this is by switching to a transient solution, which can capture more detailed flow behavior over time. So, I'll go to the general settings, change the time setting from steady to transient, and then move on to run calculation. I'll set the time step size to 0.1 seconds. Note that a large time step size may cause the solution to diverge. In this example, 20 time steps are sufficient. Now, to monitor the heat transfer coefficient over time, I'll add a report plot. I'll right-click on Report Definitions, go to the New section, and under Surface Report, select Facet Average. Now, select the wall surface. In the Field Variable section, change the variable from pressure to wall fluxes and choose Surface Heat Transfer Coefficient. Click OK, and now we can observe how the heat transfer coefficient varies with time. Let's go ahead and run the simulation. The solution is complete. As you can see, the fluctuations are very small and the results are quite close to the steady-state solution, confirming that our original setup was already pretty accurate. The video has ended. Thanks a lot for watching. I hope you found it useful.